got a problem. To no one's surprise, the New York Knicks had another disappointing year filled with inconsistent effort on the court, another coach fired before the season ended, and James Dolan continuing to be the worst owner in the NBA, kicking fans out for telling him to sell the team. The Knicks had actually offered a lot of hope for the team's future when they traded away their best draft pick in a long time in Kristaps Porzingis. The plan was to sign two superstar free agents in the summer of 2020, and draft a once-in-a-generation talent in the draft to create their own big three. When the Knicks finished with the worst record in the league, that dream scenario looked like a real possibility. But as soon as the commissioner announced that the Knicks were picked third, that dream quickly turned into a nightmare. That led to a free agency where they weren't able to land any big-time free agents, especially the two they really wanted. Despite that, Knicks fans really actually believe that this team, with minor improvements to the roster, will compete for a playoff spot. A team that won only 17 games the previous year and only signed mid-level free agents in the offseason. Besides players like Marcus Morris, Taj Gibson, and Bobby Portis, the team was full of young players they needed to rely on the most. But most of the young players have yet to prove they can play winning basketball. This season represented the team's seventh consecutive losing season, since Mike Woodson and Carmelo Anthony led them to a 55-win season back in 2012-13. When Dave Fizdale was hired, he was looked at as a breath of fresh air for the franchise. A legit coach with some head coaching experience that had some success with his previous team. But with the roster he was given, it was unlikely that he could turn this roster into a winning roster this season. Bringing in so many new players is always a challenge. And you add to the fact that all those new players were mid-level guys at best, and you shouldn't expect anything less than a losing season. Everybody around the league were confused when the Knicks started out 2-8, and the team president had an impromptu press conference after they got blown out by the lowly Cleveland Cavaliers.
We just felt like, given that this is our 10th game, we felt we had an obligation to come and speak to you guys. Obviously, Scott and I are not happy with where we are right now. We think the team's not performing to the level that we anticipated or we expected it to perform at, and it's something that we think we collectively have to do a better job of delivering the product on the floor that we said we would do at the start of this season. We still believe in our coaching staff. We believe in the plan that Scott and I put together and the players that we've assembled, but we also have to acknowledge that we haven't played at the level we expected to play at. We've seen glimpses of how we can play as a team when everything comes together, but we've got to find a way to play complete games at the level that we expect our team to play at. And that's a responsibility that we take collectively, but I also think it's important for us to communicate to our fans that we're not happy.
They really expected this team to be better with the roster they had put out there on the court. It was really hard watching the Knicks at times this season. It seemed like the players were just taking turns trying to score the ball. The Knicks players all tried creating their own opportunities without the help of their teammates. After 22 games, the Knicks were a dreadful 4-18 and was currently on an 8-game losing streak. A change needed to be made. In early December, the Knicks fired head coach Dave Fizdale, who was 21-83 in less than two full seasons as the Knicks head coach. When things are going bad, it's usually the head coach that gets blamed the most and is the first one to go. I'm not sure if Fizdale is a good coach or not, but not many coaches could have gotten this team close to playoff contention in the last two seasons with the players that was on the team. Mike Miller took over as interim head coach and was able to get this team to play like an actual NBA team around the All-Star break. He finished with a 17-27 record, which is sort of an accomplishment with this team. When you have so many new players on the team, it takes some time for them to get used to playing with each other. By the time the Knicks were somewhat comfortable playing with each other, the season was already halfway over. Julius Randle was looked at initially as a good signer for the team, a player that was still young at the age of 25 and had just put up All-Star level numbers with the Pelicans the previous year. He was somebody the Knicks fans could rally around to help turn the franchise in the right direction, but it was everything but. You can make the argument that Randle was the worst signing in the offseason. If you just look at the numbers he put up this season, you would think he played like an all-star. But he is the classic case of a player putting up empty stats. A player that takes away the flow of the offense and plays isolation basketball. Any coach loves a player that plays with high confidence, but that confidence can be a blessing and a curse. If you have a player that has great talent, you have no problem with them playing with that kind of confidence. But a player like Julius Randle is simply not good enough to be the best player on the winning team. He's basically a ball-dominant 6'8 forward who can't shoot. Spacing was a huge problem for the Knicks this season. His game is actually holding back the development of players like RJ Barrett and Mitchell Robinson, who are both looked at as the future of the team. Barrett is not a good three-point shooter yet, and Mitchell Robinson doesn't take them. And you add a player like Randle to the mix, who takes most of the shots on the team and doesn't give any spacing, and you have one of the worst three-point shooting teams in the league. That's something you don't want to be in this era. Randle was even worse on the other end of the floor. He's a bad team defender and individual defender. He has shown very little effort on that side of the ball for most of his career, and it seemed to get worse this season. Randle signed a 3-year, $63 million contract last offseason, and the third year is a team option. If he's still on the team and there's no dramatic change to the roster, he will look at himself as the best player and is going to want his touches. Randle carries himself like a star player, but the results he has provided on the floor are not even close to the impact of a legit star player. Trading Randle will be easier said than done. Just giving him away without anything in value in return will be a win for the Knicks. But how many teams you think would want a player like Randle on their team right now? Somebody who isn't easy to play with on offense, a bad defensive player, and is making around $19 million this upcoming season. Chances are that Randle will be back with his team next season, which is bad news for the Knicks. Some people think RJ Barrett will be a superstar, some think he will be just an average player. I think he falls somewhere in the middle. But most importantly, I believe he can be a winning basketball player on this level. Most rookies struggle with their shooting percentages, and that was no different with RJ Barrett. But you can always count on him to bring supreme effort. His tenacity, aggressiveness, and mentality were on full display this season. Barrett gained the respect from players and the Knicks front office. I expect him to take on more of a leadership role this upcoming season. He has that type of personality to challenge his teammates to get better, someone who is always motivating the people around him. But his 61% from the free throw line is concerning. Usually, if you can hit a good percentage of your free throws, there's a good possibility for that player to see some improvement in their outside shooting. Dennis Smith Jr. is not the player that fans expected him to be. He is a player that has more style than substance. He can give you a good highlight reel here and there, but he's actually not a good basketball player right now. It's nearly impossible to overstate how bad of a player he was this past season. You will struggle to find a player who played worse than him this season. It was not surprising to see Alfred Payton take over as the starting point guard for the Knicks. I suggested that might happen in my season preview. I thought Payton could be the steady point guard the team needed, and he was more than a willing passer. He looks for his teammates more than he looks to score, and that mentality is what the Knicks desperately needed. Payton is one of the players that has a team options for next season. I believe they should definitely bring him back, whether as a starter or a backup. He had an assist-to-turnover ratio of 3.36, which was one of the best of any player in the top 10 in assists per game. Payton had the second best net rating on the team after Mitchell Robinson. The team just simply played better when Payton was on the court. Neil Akina has played 3 seasons in the NBA, and he's still a work in progress. We've seen flashes here and there, but he has never sustained enough success in this game, except for defense. If he ever wants to get consistent minutes, everybody knows he will have to become a better offensive player, a more consistent offensive player, specifically a better and more consistent outside shooter. Going into his 4th season and his last year of his rookie contract, it's put up or shut up for Neil Akina. The problem is that the Knicks have been rumored to be in favor of drafting a point guard in the upcoming draft. Prospects like LaMelo Ball and Killian Hayes have been linked to the New York Knicks. That will make the point guard position even more crowded. And a player like Dennis Smith Jr. could be on the outside looking in, by either being buried on the bench, traded, or even cut from the team. It's still very early, but the future doesn't look so bright for the former 9th overall pick Kevin Knox. I still believe Knox has the talent to be a productive NBA player, but he seemed to lose all confidence in his sophomore season. I believe his defense was the main reason he didn't get a lot of playing time down the stretch. He's too slow to guard twos and threes, and he's not strong enough to guard fours. Knox ranked 32nd in minutes per game this season among his draft class. In the fall, the Knicks have to make a decision on whether to exercise the 4th year of his rookie contract. And there are rumors that the new team president is not sold on the potential of Knox. The firing of President Steve Mills was long overdue. In February, before the trade deadline, the Knicks announced that Mills would step down as president, which came less than 2 months after Fizdale was fired. There are always concerns with the Knicks because they probably have the worst owner in the NBA. But the hiring of former player agent Leon Rose as the team president could be a game changer for the franchise. The Golden State Warriors GM Bob Myers was a former agent before he was hired in the front office. The Knicks have chosen that same path along with other franchises. Rose has built relationship in the player community, which is big in today's NBA. In the past, he has represented NBA stars like LeBron James and Allen Iverson. And the Knicks made another surprising move in the front office. William Wesley, aka Worldwide West, has long been a big influential figure in college and pro basketball. He has joined the Knicks as an executive vice president and senior basketball advisor. Wesley is also a longtime associate of Leon Rose. Wesley is one of the most well-connected and respected people in the basketball community. He has mostly kept a low profile and rarely gives interviews or talks about his business. You add him alongside a former player agent like Leon Rose, and you could say that the Knicks are taking a nice step forward. The Knicks need somebody who can leverage their relationship with players to lure them to making the Knicks a primetime destination for free agents again. In recent decades, the Knicks have had a problem attracting star players. They have mostly swung and missed on many of their biggest targets. The Knicks have a roster filled with players on non-guaranteed deals and team options, which gives Leon Rose a lot of flexibility in turning over the roster. But you could also argue that keeping most of the players would be better for team chemistry going into next season. I had the Knicks winning 24 games this season. If they would have played a full 82-game schedule, they would have more than likely won more, but overall it still would have been a disappointing season, where most of the players on the team played below expectations. But another good draft for the Knicks could have them a step closer to playoff contention.